Where did we stop yesterday?
So we were discussing the case, Legby versus McDonald's.
Huh, yes. Did anyone go and look back on that case, on McDonald's? A little more reading? Any other cases that are similar to Donahue that you came across in your readings? Any other case? Did you come across a Mountain Dew case? They found a mouse in a bottle of Mountain Dew. Familiar with Mountain Dew? What's Mountain Dew? It's a bit like 7-Up, no? Sold by which company? Pepsi. So somebody found a mouse again. Recently, it's not Donahue's time, more recently. And sued in the United States. You know what Mountain Dew's defense was? Very creative defense. But it shot itself in the foot. Said, well, he claims to have seen a mouse, a full-fledged mouse in the bottle. And it's been more than 7 days since the bottle was released. If there was a mouse in the bottle, and it's more than 7 days, the mouse would never remain a mouse because our drink is so potent that it would have squashed the mouse. It would have, because that's what happens, you know, with Pepsi and all that, it crumbles your bones. So the poor mouse's bones would have been crumbled. Its cranial skull, you know, its cranium, skull would have crushed under the influence of this potent Mountain Dew. And you would have only seen a jelly-like shape. There would have been no mouse. So they won the argument, right? It's like winning the war, losing the battle, or winning the battle, losing the war. What is it? Winning the battle, but losing the ultimate war. Because who's going to buy Mountain Dew? I mean, this is like telling people that Mountain Dew is extremely dangerous for you. If they can turn a mouse into jelly, imagine what it does to your insides. Right? Very interesting case. But anyway, here again they settled quite quickly in Mountain Dew. And so we don't have a court ruling. Interesting case nonetheless. Any other cases? Any other cases that you came across? So McDonald's is one, Mountain Dew is the other. Here. This is what they stated. Right? That if it was there in Mountain Dew for a week, it would have no calcium left in its bones and bony structures. All the calcium would have depleted. The bones would have crumbled. What happens when there's no calcium in the bone? Goes, no? All your osteoporosis, osteoarthritis, all those are, you know, when calcium depletes from the bones. That's why old people have problems. No calcium. Right? What does Mountain Dew? It takes away the calcium. And says the mouse's abdominal structure will rupture and its cranial cavity is also likely to rupture. This was the... So somebody said this was the ad line for a long time for Mountain Dew. Yahoo Mountain Dew. It'll tickle your innards. Innards means inside. Somebody said you should substitute with dissolve your innards. So it does. Okay. Then we come to what if arguments. What if there was clear glass on the Donahue bottle? Think back. This is how you play with fact situations. You turn it around in your head. What if there was clear glass? We discussed a bit of it yesterday, right? Am I duty bound to inspect as a consumer? What if there's a clear glass? Am I duty bound to inspect as a cafe owner? Make that a question. Ishwar, make that into a question. If there is a duty to inspect a product, on whom should the duty lie? Right? Answer with reference to policy arguments. Because then some of them can go to policy. Policy arguments means who's, if you look at an economic, policy arguments, you can come at it from any angle. You can come at it from an economic angle. Economically, who should bear the cost? You can come at it from a sociological angle. You can come at it from a morality angle. Anything. Policy is wide, vast. Ishwar, one more question. What does it take to be a good policy lawyer? Maybe some can reflect on that. Right?
So when we talk about policy, so yesterday I went and read about a quote from Winfield.
Sir, and Jolowitz on TOTS.
Yeah.
Huh? Yes, on TOT law.
Sir,
very good.
Yes, sir. So,
that's a good book. Yes, Winfield and Jolowitz is much better than your R&D.
Yes.
You've read Winfield and Jolowitz? Nobody's read? That's a very good book. Salmond on TOTS? You have Salmond on TOTS? What are the TOT books do you have in your library? Did anyone go and look at what TOT books you have in your library?
So we have Hartwood on that.
Very good. Then?
So we have Winfield book on
that. Winfield and Jolowitz. It's not only Winfield. There's Jolowitz, who's a co-author. Is it only Winfield?
I'll check it again.
Then?
Sir, these two books. And apart from this, sir, we have
all the others. The trash, the one that should be put in Mountain Dew bottles. Its innards should be shredded and ruptured, never to see the light of the day. Okay, what did Winfield say?
So he said that the courts must decide not simply whether there is or is not a duty, but whether there should or should not be one, taking into account both established framework of law and also the implications that the decision one way or the other may or operation of law.
Perfect. Quote the sentence in its entirety and say, was Winfield right? Should the courts decide whether there should be a duty of care? Or is it the court's job to simply say that under the law there is a duty of care? But can the court carve out new duties of care? Can the court carve out new duties of care? That's a question for you. Evaluation.
So,
can reflect on it.
So there was also this thing that there are two types of policies, the dating policy decisions and the explicit policy decisions.
Mm-hmm.
So sir, what started happening after Donogh versus Stevenson was that the judges start taking the decision in abstract terms, started giving compensation to the claimants. Actually, there was a mention of floodgates doctrine.
Mm-hmm.
The cases started spreading and people started claiming on the basis of Donogh versus
mm-hmm.
Stevenson.
Mm-hmm.
Then there were two types of judgment that were being floated, that the dating policies were the one which did not discuss much about the policy, and framing the decision, basic decision on the Donogh versus Stevenson, just granting the compensation. Then they came the explicit policy decisions, where the judges entirely went into the jurisprudence and developed jurisprudence. So that is more favorable. That is important in any country, that to develop jurisprudence and build upon it. That is more.
Very good. I'm glad at least somebody went back and read. Excellent. Excellent. So he says there are two ways. Judges sometimes never tell you why they decide the way they do. So there could be a underlying reason why the judge has come up with an interpretation, but they will never tell you. Because that would either reveal a prejudice or it's too much work. But we want judges to articulate their reasons. Because these are not democratically elected officials. They don't have legitimacy in a democracy through elections, and yet they decide your rights, liabilities. They have huge control over your life. You've not elected them. So how else do we make them accountable? How else do they draw their legitimacy apart from reasoning and public reasoning? Right? So it is incumbent on judges to tell us how they've decided and why they've decided the way they've decided, because it's the only way we can hold an unelected, powerful public servant accountable. Right? And these are public servants. These are functionaries of the state in a broad sense. They're constitutional functionaries. They have enormous power. In fact, if you look at in India, they possibly have more power than any other wing. Right? I mean, they can bring prime ministers and chief ministers before them. They can issue contempt notices. They can make policy. They can bring back the Kohinoor. They can stop jokes, Sardar jokes. I mean, this is a powerful, powerful body. They can use their section 482 and 151 to do pretty much what they want. Right? We need to make them accountable. The only way to account is through public reasoning. So judicial reasoning in a public format, clearly articulating the reasons as to why they decide the way they do, is absolutely important for a well-functioning democracy, for rule of law, and for us as lawyers and law students to understand how laws are made, right? Okay, good. Namrata, you're okay? You weren't supposed to come in today. I just told them that the rub was too strong, that you fell ill.
Huh? Actually, sir, they started, today's Ganesha Chaturthi, they started playing drums and all, so I was like, this is a much better.
This is better, no? At least I don't play drums in class. Huh? I only do drones, I don't do drums. I prefer a drone. You know the other meaning of drone, no? Go on, drone. Okay. Okay, so we did this. Then there's another case of dermatitis. Somebody contracted dermatitis, a skin condition, after wearing again track pants and sued in Australia. A case called Grant Knitting Company or something. Who knows the case? You want to come across the case? None of you did any moot courts on tort law? No? Nobody frames moot courts on tort anymore, right?
Yes.
They do it on artificial intelligence and IP and
space law.
Maritime. Maritime law, but nothing on family law. All those are the... Nobody wants those. We had on tort law. That's why we remember. We had two moot courts at least on tort law. So then you're forced to go and read. Grant.
Yes.
Tell us what it is.
It was a Grant versus Australian Knitting Union.
Ah, very good.
So, the claimant suffered dermatitis caused by a chemical used in the manufacture of woolly underpants made by the defendants. So, basically the ratio was that the duty of care was owed to him and defendant were liable even though the illness he suffered was extremely rare.
But they make them liable. I thought they said that there was no causation. They couldn't prove that the causation here. In this tort case was slightly different because they couldn't show that the dermatitis resulted directly as a result of this cloth or this material. Dermatitis can result from different, or dermatitis. What is it, dermatitis or dermatitis?
Dermatitis.
Dermatitis can result from a variety of factors. There was no causal correlation here. That's the other thing, no? Duty of care, breach of the duty, means a causation and a direct and damage as a result of the breach. So I had a duty of care to make the right set of materials in the pans. I breached that duty because the material wasn't great. And as a result, you suffered damage. But if your suffering of damage had nothing to do with my breach of duty, you're not liable. I can breach any duty, right? There can be 1,000 duties in society. I can breach 1,000 duties. But if those breach of duties don't cause any consequent damage, you're off the hook. Correct? It's almost like saying you go into an exam hall, you cheat, you take in papers, you're not caught, you're off the hook, no? Only when you're caught, it's a problem. Similarly, only when somebody is damaged, there's a problem. Otherwise, you can breach. But when you breach, you run a risk, because somebody could be damaged. And in this, it was, go look back at the case. Study it because maybe you're reading the first instance decision. It may have gone up in appeal, but find out. We'll get to the root of it. Or maybe I've got it wrong here. Anyway, okay. Now the interesting case, as I mentioned, is preemption. And we have an Indian case too. Other case, if you look at Dinesh Samanta, which in fact, some of our IDIA scholars are working on in Bengal, which is a case where somebody found a frog. Right? The Indian touch was a frog, not a mouse. Not a snail, but a frog inside a cough syrup in the state of West Bengal. Cough syrup. Right? Interesting set of dynamics because a lot of us, some of us, who eat frogs or frog legs. So then to argue that the frog caused severe problems may have been slightly difficult, especially if it's in a community that eats frogs. Anyone eat frogs? Frog legs? No. It's a French delicacy. It's a rural delicacy in some parts, including in Kerala. Many years ago, before I found that killing animals was not such a good thing. We did it ourselves, killing frogs and eating and chopping off their legs and frying them. We got a lot of frogs in Kerala, in the remote parts, in paddy fields. Very easy to kill frogs because you shine a torch light on them in the paddy field. First, they give off where they are because they got beautiful music, no? They croak. They're croaking all right through the field, so you know exactly where they are. Then you shine a nice bright torch light on them. What does the frog do? When you shine a torch light on them, they don't move. They gaze up at it, transfixed. And then in a very cruel procedure, you whack them, kill them, and then take only their legs. And then you fry those legs en masse. So on a good night, you may get about 100 frogs. It's 200 legs. Of course, now it's banned. It used to be widely prevalent. Now it's banned because frogs are, a lot of frogs are endangered species. And they're on these lists, so now you can't do it. And of course, it's also, I mean, for those of you on the moral side of things, yeah, I think it dawned on me quite late, but it was reprehensible that we kill these animals. Anyway, but so frogs in the cough syrup, and the chemist was arrested, not the manufacturer. The chemist who sold it to the pure, unsuspecting patient who wanted the cough syrup opened it and found a dead frog inside. When in complaint to the cops, this particular consumer, and they arrested the chemist, who was called Dinesh Samantar. They never prosecuted the manufacturer, which is what our IDIA scholars found out in Bengal. It's very strange. And so they wanted to go after the case, find out a little more detail. But it turns out that the manufacturer supported Dinesh Samanta in providing money for his defense. So he got off the hook. And manufacturer, of course, no prosecution. And you're wondering why this country is so safe when it comes to drugs and devices. This is what they do. They let the main guy off the hook. We've got drug regulatory norms here. You go after a poor chemist. Luckily, fortunately for him, the manufacturer at least paid his expenses, made sure he's off the hook. But otherwise, he would have gone to jail. Manufacturer would have been off the hook. So I want some of you to assess India's drug regulatory norms also. Right? One is it working? The other is an interesting question. If you have a drug regulatory norm through a statute, can you then bring in the old tort remedies? If you've got a drug regulator, and the drug regulator sets standards, can you have a duty of care beyond that standard? Or will the standard be a complete code for that duty of care? So can I argue that, well, there's a regulatory structure in place, and I've complied with all the regulations. And if I've complied with all the regulations, then how can you make me liable under a different species, you know, bringing in duty of care under tort law? Whatever duty of care was there earlier under tort law has now been codified, specified, adapted to meet the requirements of the drug industry specifically. You can't now impose a more vague general standard on me. Make that a question. Ishwar? And it plays out in the J&J case as well. J&J can say that, well, we complied with all the regulatory norms. I mean, that's in question. They say we complied, others say they didn't. But assume that they complied. If they did comply, can you still make them liable under other theories? Or the fact that there's a specific statute preempts the application of more general principles of law? That's a very interesting question in tort law.
Is it not the duty of the court to implead manufacturer as a party, as a necessary party?
In what? In?
In the this problem.
Huh, but it's a prosecution. It's not a necessary, it's not gone to court. It's the regulator who has to prosecute. You see, and that's an interesting question again. Who can prosecute? What discretion do they have? For those of you, how many studying criminal law here? And you will come up with this tie day in and day out. In a lot of regulatory statutes, when you go out into the field of legal practice, you will find that you must know your criminal law also. Because a lot of this stuff is also criminally culpable. And regulators are often faced with this problem of how do we take action against every violator, especially through the criminal route. And statutes sometimes are not very clear. You know, I advise a body called the National Biodiversity Authority, which administers India's biodiversity laws. And a constant problem that we faced was that there's not enough guidance on who to prosecute, when to prosecute, how to prosecute. There are violators. And in fact, the Biodiversity Act is structured in such a way that it's very difficult to understand. One could read it literally to almost suggest that any researcher that goes into a conference, foreign researcher, and gets the conference speaker, gives them some gyan on some knowledge associated with a biological resource. The moment they impart in that gyan, because they've heard it, they become ipso facto violators. That's how strange one reading of the act can be. The moment you touch a biological resource or you get access to knowledge associated with a biological resource, you come under the purview of the National Biodiversity Authority and the Act, and you cannot access the resource or knowledge associated with it without prior permission of the authority. It's almost like saying, my God, I heard it, let me close my ears. Right? But too late, because you already heard it. Before you hear it, you should have sought permission. But you didn't know you were going to hear it. This is how our legislations are drafted. It's difficult enough for judges to articulate. Now you put the onus on parliamentarians. Tell us, how you legislated the way you legislated? Why? Because in parliament, if you see how parliament works, they will have 50 bills in one day. Not a single one would have read a single provision of any bill. There'll be a party stand, support it, don't support it, it's voted on. Very few will read the bill. And yet, when it comes to the judiciary, we have to say parliamentary intent. It's a funny thing, no? Forget intent, these fellows have never read. What intention can you ascribe to them? This is what parliament intended. Our intention requires application of mind. Where have they applied their mind? They've signed blankly, blank checks and signed karte. They've signed it. And yet, this is a legal fiction again. You come to the court and say, parliament intended. Let's try and see what they thought. That's how you get all these stupid legislations. But anyway, short point is, the Biodiversity Authority can prosecute. Now, if it has to prosecute everyone that violates the law, what does it do? I mean, our jails are going to be packed. Our jails are going to be packed. It's like during the 377 judgment, we made the argument that, well, under existing Indian norms, natural sex is only procreative sex. Which means that the function of sex is only to produce children. And only when you engage in sex with a view to commit children, would you be engaging in natural sex. Everything else is unnatural. By which logic, even condom usage becomes unnatural. So you're not procreating. And if that's the case, imagine how many people go to jail. No laws are made. So do they have prosecutorial discretion? That's an important question that'll come up. Do they have the discretion to prosecute only the egregious cases, or should they prosecute any violation under the Act? If so, who should prosecute? Who can take action? Somebody has to go file a complaint with the magistrate. You can't prosecute directly. You don't have the constitutional competence to directly prosecute, correct? Unless, of course, the statute gives you special powers, but otherwise you can't directly. You can initiate the process of prosecution, but it has to go before a magistrate's court, typically, right? So even under special statutes, that Copyright Act or whatever that says is a criminal offense, it's not like the copyright registrar is going to take action against you criminally. He can't. He can initiate the process. It has to go through the normal criminal route. And in Samantha as well, this is what happened. They initiated the prosecution through the regulatory thing, but the regulator has the power to figure out who to. And obviously, you pay off the regulator, they're not going to prosecute you. They'll prosecute the small guy. That's what typically happens. No? You catch the small fry, you leave the bigger ones, because the bigger ones you don't want to touch. They pay you off, or they're too powerful. They'll transfer you out. And that's what we're seeing here. Right? Okay, should we do Aadhaar first or J&J first? Aadhaar? Okay, then the Aadhaar people, please. Take your respective positions on the battlefield. Bring all the arsenal with you, including weapons of mass destruction. Okay. Who's for other, against other?
For.
Oh, for. Okay, so you need to limit your issues to breaches, privacy, security, actionability. Yeah? Not so much on constitutionality. Okay? Because that's not the challenge. So you have sued. Start. Sure.
So basically we are against the notion that Aadhaar should be implemented in India, and we are challenging basically on three grounds. The first one being the Aadhaar Act.
You don't want Aadhaar to be implemented in India?
Yes. Not made mandatory on in India. It should be optional. And
that's not the dispute at all.
So basically we are questioning the right of Aadhaar.
So on breaches, on accountability, on liability.
Sure, sir. So,
we're not on constitutionality, we're not on policy wise is it desirable or not. Those arguments you weave in to the main argument on whether there's a liability for breach.
Okay.
I made that very clear.
Sure.
Stay within the course of the course.
Sure. So, I'll list down some of the infrastructural problems, particularly with respect to the security and what all CIDR is doing. So basically, there were some flaws in Aadhaar implementation.
Mm-hmm.
So first of all, I'll be going through the Aadhaar itself. So
uh-huh.
It was introduced in 2009, mm-hmm. and the first time the regulation was introduced in by 2016.
Mm-hmm.
Before it, there was no regulatory measure as to how the Aadhaar would be used, or what all regulation are to be followed.
Mm-hmm.
So my first issue is that the data that was collected in between 2009 to 2016,
mm-hmm.
It was almost 50 million people have registered in that period of time.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no data as to what all were the breaches in this period of time. There was no there was regulatory authority, but it was not statutory authority.
Mm-hmm.
The UIDA got its statutory backing by the 2016 Act. So
okay.
There was no as such codified laws which talks about as to how the Aadhaar data is to be protected. So basically, in these 7 years, the number
so
of...
So what is the argument? Make the legal argument.
Yes, sir, the legal
if
argument,
there is no statutory basis for an authority that collects the data, then what?
Sir, the implication of this is that the data which was collected in this 7 years, it was not protected at all. There was no strict regulatory action.
It was not protected under what?
It was not protected by any statute. There was no regulatory measures.
Is it not protected by statute or was it not protected by law?
Not protected by statute. Because there was no provision as to if there is a breach
so
of that data.
Not protected by statute and by law.
Yes.
So no protection at all.
Yes.
So his argument now, and I throw it open to the class, is that there is no protection for this data because it was collected there was no statute governing its regulation. Is that correct? No, why not? IT Act.
Sir, but
will apply. Apart from IT Act? ISO guidelines. Are they law in the country? Is an ISO guideline a law? Or is it a voluntary standard that you comply with? It's a voluntary standard. It's not binding. Then? What about common law? You've been discussing common law the whole time. Can you say that there's no statute governing this, therefore all my common law rights go out of the window? In fact, that's a better argument for bringing in common law, right? There's no other remedy. I bring in common law. At least if there's a remedy, somebody can argue preemption. That there is a remedy under the statute, so now it's preempted, old law. But here, if there's no law at all, there's no question of preemption. It's a better argument.
Sir, but there was no specific penal provision with respect to that. Like today...
Why do you need a penal provision only? To hold somebody accountable, especially for damages. Accountability can come with civil accountability or with criminal accountability.
Yes, sir, I agree to that, but...
Liability can be either criminal or civil.
Sir, So, but still there was till 2016 there was no criminal liability, and also there was no specific.
No, again, look at the criminal, the IPC. Is there any provision in the IPC that can help you? Come on, those of you study criminal law. Again, you can do a creative shot there and bring in provisions and prosecute under those. In fact, have that as a question. Criminal liability for breach of Aadhaar, right? Outside of the Aadhaar Act, or before, as you rightly said, before the onset of the Aadhaar Act. Okay, then?
Okay, sir. So my second argument is, which is also prevailing today, there's a problem, that is, who is authorized to take my biometrics? Now, my argument is based on one of the incidents that has happened, where the Bharti Airtel, which was selling the SIM, their biometrics were also used without the consent of the consumer to open Airtel payment bank account. So almost 22 lakhs accounts were opened online. And almost 47 crore money was deposited in this 22 lakhs account. So when this whole controversy came up, their license was suspended, and it was found that almost 5,000 website applications which were using your biometrics without your consent. So
okay, I think he's led us on to a brilliant point that I wanted to make in this class, which is that when we went to law school, we were all taught that we have to be social engineers. You heard the term? From where? Who's a sociologist? Pound. Right? So Pound gave us social engineering. Lawyers are social engineers. What are these classes seeking to do? What are these classes seeking to do? And he's illustrated it beautifully just now. He has built the superstructure, and all his arguments you'll notice are superstructures. Biometric mein ye hua, ye hua, ye hua, but he's not gone to the fundamental basis. You see what I'm saying? And that's the problem that we have today. It's not only you, everyone, so don't take it personally. But you see, the problem is Twitter, LinkedIn, what we hear is biometric, this, that, this, so we get all these high-flown concepts on top, but we're not able to link it back down. When we link it back down, we say, okay, what is this? What is really happening here? Somebody is collecting biometric, he's now given Airtel, and he says, well, they didn't collect it with consent. But a more fundamental issue, should Airtel have the authority at all, even with your consent, to use the Aadhaar authentication mechanism? Why should the statute provide leeway to a private enterprise to use something that was collected in pursuit of a public policy to drive its private business? That's a more fundamental question. So now he's asking a relevant question, but he's asking a superstructure question. He's asking the leaf. He's not going to the trunk. The trunk really is, under what circumstances should we permit the state and others authorized by the state to collect our data? One is, of course, they will collect our data through private arrangement. Again, we go back to contract. That's pure contract, right? It's my autonomy. I decide if I want to sacrifice it. If I want to give all of my data to Google, that's my choice. State has no role in it. Google says, give me all your data and I will give you free email, and I will give you free ads, and I will give you free Google glasses, maybe, at some point. Maybe even I'll give you a free self-driving car if you give enough of your data. Right? That's between you and I. We're mature enough, we're adult. If we're stupid, we live with it. Giving away too much. The other is a state-sanctioned collection of data. State first says, I want to collect data for a public purpose. Right? This is how Aadhaar started. They said, I want to collect for a public purpose. This Aadhaar is for a public purpose because I have to disburse subsidies and benefits to people that deserve it. Correct? I have to disburse subsidies. And there's huge problems in the present PDS system, public distribution system, other systems where people that are beneficiaries don't get what the state is giving them. Rations, kerosene oil, rice. These are not reaching the intended beneficiaries because the middleman is siphoning off. One. Second question is, not only is it a middleman problem, it is a problem of people that are not eligible for these PDS benefits coming in and claiming it on the basis of fake cards, fake IDs. So if we want to wipe this out, we want to have one ID, an authentic ID, an authentic system that will ensure that the benefits we provide as a state reach the people for whom it is intended. This is how it started. Then what happened? Suddenly we said we'll give Airtel the same benefit. So Airtel now steps into the shoes of the state, because now the state can give you an ID and can authenticate that ID at each of the points at which it provides services to you. Now it says even the private player can use the same mechanism to authenticate when it provides not a public service but a private service. You see from where to where we've gone? Now the question of consent there is meaningless. We're not on consent. We're on using a state machinery for a private purpose now. Would you be okay with Airtel doing this if you gave the consent? Because Airtel is now using state machinery. It's using a state-created database. That's the fundamental question. You see, break it down into fundamentals. So Pound may have said become a social engineer, but what I'm trying to make you do is to become a reverse engineer. What is reverse engineering? You break it down. Become like a child. You give a toy to a child, you give a machine to a child, what does it do? Thodo. It will break it. And try and see, of course, the curious child will try and see what's inside. So when you see Aadhaar, break it. See what is inside. Go to the root. Do what the old scientists did. They had a substance, they broke it down. Molecule, atom, neutron, positron, quark. Find out exactly what the, at its lowest common denominator, what is this material? Or in the legal parlance, what is the Grund norm? What is the fundamental norm? So more than a social engineer, I wanted to be a reverse engineer. Right? Unless you're a good reverse engineer, you can't be a social engineer. Social engineering means you're changing society. How can you change society without understanding how society is built in the first place? That's why you have to think through these basics. Become like a PK. Come in and say, experience wonder. How is it that these rules are operational? What is the fundamental purpose of this rule? Question it. Then you will get answers. You will get ideas. Okay? Break it down. I want it down, 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 down. Like to a six-year-old, explain it. Become a child. Reverse engineer it. Okay.
Sir, also the basis, the preamble of the Aadhaar Act itself says that it is introduced for proper for good governance.
One more, I should add that as a question.
For good governance and targeted delivery of subsidies, benefits and services. Now when we see in India, most of
How can lawyers be reverse engineers? And then we give them full flow and let them come up with their own thoughts. Or maybe you can contextualize it later with the case or something.
Sorry to interrupt, sir, but you started off saying that you should ascertain whether the main issue should be on the breaches part of it and not on the constitutionality. I believe here we cannot understand or ascertain as to the concepts of or aspects of breach, because this is far more technical matter. As far as this, I mean, we are concerned, we could focus more on the constitutionality.
No. You bring in constitutionality only to understand the breaches. We'll come to it. Let him finish.
So the objective of the act is for good governance and targeted delivery of subsidies and
correct. Benefits.
Now most of the benefit owners or beneficiaries of this are from rural India.
Mm-hmm.
Now when we talk about rural India, there are number of places where they don't have even basic amenities such as electricity. And for implementation of Aadhaar, you need authentication, and for that you need people who are using the computers, who are using the device for authentication process.
Mm-hmm.
Now they don't have electricity. Secondly, they even don't have basic internet connection, because from where I belong to, although it's a town, but there are some problems with respect to the internet connectivity.
So what?
So the
build it up. I want the argument to be built up. Because there's no internet, because there's no this, there's a huge problem with infrastructure. So what?
So because of this, the objective is not achieved, because the people are not
connected to the breaches. Okay, this answers your question. I'll show you how to connect it.
So
connected to the breaches.
Recently in Jharkhand also, there was one woman who went to a PDS or ration shop for getting ration.
Fundamentals, go back. What does it mean? When you have a really crappy system at the bottom line to collect the data, what happens? It's a vulnerable ecosystem. Anyone can come in. It's exactly what we're seeing with Aadhaar, right? Because of the fact that you have collected data in an environment where nothing is secure, you have given the provision of collecting of data to various people who were not trained, who had no clue. Village level operators, in fact, if you read Rachna Kaira's story, she was sitting at one of these centers once, and she saw this one of these operators with a small laptop, his own personal laptop, with all other details. How did it come on a personal laptop? He said, well, I can't print it from this machine, so I take it here and I go print it elsewhere. Now, what is to keep him from transferring the data somewhere else? It's gone, no, it's left. It's like Chidambaram said when they issued the virtual ID. Now they said we won't have the actual Aadhaar number, we'll have a virtual number. So it masks, because now there's a whole controversy about the number, no? Dinesh Sharma comes up and says, this is my number, Aadhaar number. What's his name? Dinesh Sharma?
Yeah.
Tri-Chief. This is my Aadhaar number, see what you can do with it. What do they do? Not only found out, they ordered a OnePlus phone also for him. Cash on pay. They found images of him with his daughter. Put that up online, right? Lots of things. So because of the fact that an Aadhaar number is problematic, if it's revealed, now they say we'll give a virtual ID. But when they're giving a virtual ID, what does Chidambaram say? What is the point? The horses have bolted from the stable. You've created such a ruinous system. Now whatever you do on top of that, it is like saying that I have cancer. I'm dying, you know? My body is withering away. What do? I put Band-Aid. Can you put Band-Aids and solve cancer? It's a deep malaise. It's rotten from the inside. And why? Because of all that estates. No infrastructure, no thing. You've given it to unauthorized people. You've given it to people, unqualified people. You've created a vast network, insecure network. By design, you are designed to perpetrate breaches. You are not designed to offer security. Can we make that argument that by design itself, the fundamental design itself is so flawed that breaches will happen at a far more rigorous rate than you can expect from an IT system? That's the argument you need to make. That's where the linkage is. Okay.
So also there was a news yesterday where a person was selling a patch. If you buy just for 2500, so if you buy that patch and if you use that, you can easily go through the security system of Aadhaar and can access number of Aadhaar.
Who's technically qualified here? It's a great point. Who can explain that in technical layman's terms? What this patch does? This latest breach of Aadhaar. Who are the IT people here? Cyber law, cyber people.
I can just explain I have not read much about that patch exactly, but what happens that patch is a certain code which is run through command prompt. So what it takes that you need not to click on anything. It is automated. Commands are there in a patch in a series, so they automatically goes inside the website and takes data from there and presents data to the that patch file only.
Yeah.
So you need not to click on anything. it will automatically take you to there and collect data from there and bring you back to the where it is started.
Additionally, what it does is that it creates a pathway, like if you have a security measure that you, if you have to log in, you have to enter the passcode, passkey, it will block those functions to work in a way, and that's how the patch works. Like it's patch up the whatever the security method that is required to access the data. And one more,
it will block access to the data.
Not block access.
It will bypass
it, open the gateway. Like there is a gateway. There is a blockade made to patch. The patch. What will it do? It will erase the code.
So it will disable. Break it down again.
Yes.
You're a lawyer explaining to a jury that doesn't have. I'm trying to get you into the art of breaking it down. It will disable the security systems that were designed to ensure that only authorized people could come in and enroll. This is about enrollment. Who can enroll into the Aadhaar database, into the Aadhaar system? Enrollment is critical, no? Who comes in? What data comes in? If that is fundamentally flawed, then anybody can break it, right? It's like saying, when I build a house, my front door, if I don't take care of, I've not taken care of my front door, right? I've made it with a lock that's a shitty Godrej door. That's a better. You samadhi, right?
Sometimes what it does, the
imagine, we use Godrej here. This one gets put on YouTube, and I get sued for disparagement. What happens, in the real world? Product disparagement. It's like that Akshay Kumar movie on Bata. Can't do that today. Let's say, okay, so some shitty lock, I don't know which one, won't name the brand, a crappy lock. And then, no matter whether you build after the front door, you build a vault and you build this, doesn't matter. This is breachable. What have you done? All the people that could collect Aadhaar data initially, they were not trained. Village-level operators. You gave access to all and sundry. Then the people that could come and fix the Aadhaar database, which is what the Khaira investigation was all about, 500 rupees you give. Those were actually access controls meant for people that could fix problems with the Aadhaar database. So you go to them and you say, something is wrong, please correct it. They can go in and change. That access is gone. Now in the recent one, this patch, security patch means what? Even whatever was remaining there, for regulating the people that can enter the system to enroll, those security features have been disabled with this patch. That means anybody else can come in. Because your entry level system itself is vulnerable. Right? When you go before judges and juries, this is the only language they'll understand. You speak in terms of what is a command prompt and all, you've lost them. Command prompt. Justice Mithilesh Bhai sitting in this court here would be scratching his head. Kya hai command prompt?